till my soul is no more, I will love you, love you. Till the sun starts to cry and the moon turns to rust, I will love you, love you. But I need to know, will you stay for all time, forever until day? Then I'll give my heart till the end of all time, forever until.
Till the storms fill my eyes and we touch the last time, I will love you, love you. Till the storms fill my eyes and we touch this time, I will love you, love you.
storms fill my eyes, and we touch the last time.
Testing. It's not working. Test. That wasn't me. Testing. It's not working.
All those who are sitting or standing, sorry, at the back of the church, to please find your seat because we are about to start. And the only persons who should be standing would be the pallbearers.
Rather than putting it on the chin. Why don't you put it?
Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. a warm welcome to all of you to the funeral service of our beloved Kimani Rivière. The first part of our celebration is going to be a number of tributes, followed by the eulogy, and then our funeral service. Our funeral service this afternoon will be conducted by our chief celebrant, Monsignor Michel Francis, as well as Father Albert Smith, assisted by Deacon David Popo. I have recognized a number of persons here in our midst, and I understood that we have some more of our dignitaries to come, so I will recognize you just before we start the service as you come in. And so, to start the first part of our celebration, and that is the tributes, I would like to call upon the dear son of Kimani, Zan Rivière.
Good afternoon, one and all. I am Zan Rivière, the son of the late Kimani Rivière, and I am going to read the tribute to my father. Father dear, from as long as I could remember, I was loved unconditionally by my parents. Today is a testament to the life of my dad, Ashanti Kimani Osai Rivière, known affectionately to most as Kiki, but Daddy to me. He made a promise to himself to do everything for his son, and he kept that promise to his dying day. I am his only son. According to my mother, my dad was most emotional over my birth. When my mother and I were discharged from the hospital, my father stopped at all his friends' houses to show off his new baby, as if I was a prize, a trophy he had won. That first night at home, when all had quieted down and my parents were the only ones left with the little human, my father took me to the living room to spend some time with me. My mother recalls that she heard crying, and when she peeked to see if everything was okay, she saw my father crying over me as he held me to his chest and whispered all his promises to me. My dad loved me from birth. My earliest memory of my father was a time when we were by my grandmother, and I was very hungry, and my dad, a man of the kitchen, whipped up the simplest yet most delicious meal, rice and corned beef. As usual, he sat with his big bowl and gave me a bowl considerably smaller to his. Of course, he had one of his signature glasses of lime juice to complement the dish. We both ate at the outside dining table and had one of our famous Zan and Daddy talks, a ritual that we both enjoyed. These talks were a hallmark of our relationship. This is how my dad shared information and conveyed his important principles to me. As I got older, these talks became more and more in-depth and mature. As a matter of fact, My dad used the hours we sat in traffic as valuable conversation time. My dad taught me to always carry yourself well. Even if he was going down the road to buy bread, he would iron his shirt and pants just to go a few yards away from home. One day, I asked him, why does he do it? And he said, I do it because I never know who I will see on the way. And in watching my dad do it all the time, I in turn started to follow in like fashion. Similarly, my father would bathe, get dressed, and put on cologne just to stay home. Another principle he taught me was to always stay humble. He stressed that humility would take you further than arrogance. So, the fact that he knew many rich and powerful people did not change his attitude to people who were seemingly poor or had less than him. He never boasted about who he knew or who he's been around. He was simply kiki to everyone. He also imparted the lesson, don't let people walk all over you. He felt the need to drill that into me because he never wanted me to allow anyone, young or old, to take advantage of me. He frequently gave me smart remarks to respond to such persons, remarks that I can't repeat here. Overall, my father wanted me to be strong, yet humble individual who would have a profitable business sense. On the topic of business, my father ensured that he taught me all he knew and all he wished he had been taught before adulthood. My dad started to teach me the ways of the kitchen at a young age. At first, this is how one of our conversations would go. Me: Daddy, can I cut the onions, please? My father: No. Me: Why? He answered simply, observe. I looked at him cluelessly, trying to wrap my head around what observe meant. I finally asked, what does it mean? And he said, just watch and learn. Eventually, I was allowed to cook. We sometimes cooked together, and other times, he supervised me. But at all times, cooking was an adventure. Another teachable moment. Another activity to do with my daddy. My father loved music. He constantly said that what passes for music nowadays is nonsense. Therefore, he made it his personal mission to introduce me to what he thought was good music. He played all genres of music, especially rap, dub, and reggae. My fondest memory of my dad was when we went on a cruise in 2017. The cruise had started out very dismally for us, but my dad ensured that I had a great time as we visited many Caribbean islands and experienced the different yet similar cultures. What made the cruise so amazing was that my dad and I did a good deal of shopping. That was my first time really getting anything I wanted on the spot. My dad took me everywhere, just like his dad did. He was sure to tell me many stories about his dad, all fond memories. His dad loved tennis, and he always wanted to play, but was limited because of his disease. So he introduced me to the sport and was extremely happy that I took such great interest in it. He would watch me play for hours with a great smile of pride and give me tips to improve my game. He was my biggest supporter. He promised that one day we will play together, but that day never came. We were a team, my dad, my mom, and I. Now the head coach of our team is gone and our team is down to two. We really miss you, Daddy. I miss you. For those of you gathered here today, and the rest of you watching via live stream, I would like you to know that my dad was a great man, a well-rounded person who tried to prepare me for life by imparting everything he could do in my short 13 years. He was the real MVP, my GOAT, the greatest of all time. I love you, Daddy. Thank you.
Thank you, Zan. I'd now like to call upon Crystal Riviere, wife of Kimani.
Good afternoon, all. As I made desperate, frantic calls on the morning of Friday, 9th October 2020, I wholeheartedly believe that God would use Kimani's situation to turn a test into a testimony. I declared as much to my friends and loved ones as I fervently begged them to pray for Kimani's recovery. In my mortal mind, I envisioned Kimani making a miraculous turn around from the brink of death and thereafter testifying to the world on the amazing healing power of God. I repeated ad nauseam that Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead after 4 whole days. And since we serve the same God, he can and will restore Kimani. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. But alas, this was not to be, and my darling was declared dead at 12:30 p.m. But God is not a man that he should lie. His ways are not our ways. So while I envisioned the delivery of this testimony differently, our omniscient Father who set this world in motion and created Kimani ordained a testimony, and that is what we are gathered here today. Kimani was an amazing man and a great husband. I will not be able to delve into every detail of our relationship because we are time constrained. But it gives me great pleasure to talk about the fantastic husband he was. I oftentimes wanted to post about our relationship and the things he did that made my heart sing, but he always stopped me. His reason? You want women to come after me, Chris? So I savored his love and affection and adoration privately. Kimani was very unconventional. We didn't celebrate Valentine's Day, for instance, but I had no need to complain. There's a common practice for me to open the passenger door and find a well-dressed single red rose on my seat after a hard day's work. Breakfast in bed was a normal part of our routine. Long drives to nowhere and everywhere was another pastime that we enjoyed. Kimani bought me chocolates, took me out to dinner, and showered me with intimate presents faithfully. I need not ask, and it didn't have to be a special occasion. You see, Kimani studied me over our near 15-year relationship, and he learned what I like in order to make me happy. He also learned my unspoken language, so he knew just what I needed and wanted before I even opened my mouth. He could tell when I was uncomfortable, irritated, and unhappy. He could also tell when I had had enough. He could predict, almost like a gade, when I would be hungry or tired or sick. He knew his wife through and through, and he spoiled me. I never had to worry about the threat of an extramarital affair because he made me feel secure. There were no late night sneaky calls, no disappearing acts, no questionable behavior. He didn't guard his phone like Fort Knox. It was left in plain sight at all times. Everything was just straightforward with him. He protected me and our relationship fiercely, even when I was not away. He kept home happy. I read somewhere that the goal of marriage is not to look great, but for it to be great, and that was our marriage. Kimani didn't care too much for Facebook and Instagram posts, but he put his all into making our marriage work in real life. As with every other relationship, we had our challenges, but something magical happened when we said, "I do." All our issues seemed to melt away or walk away, whichever way you want to look at it. Kimani made it easy for me to be a submissive wife because he loved me like Christ loved the church. This is Kimani's testimony. He was a faithful and devoted husband who ensured that his wife was happy. Delight was not achieved through the purchase of expensive, lavish gifts. Instead, he took time to learn the woman he married and paid attention to the little details. He was selfless in love and protected the happiness and peace of his home. We spoke often and about everything. Typically, at the end of our day, we would share how our day went, what made us happy, our daily triumphs, what made us sad or angry, and the plans we had going forward. I really wish I could tell him how much life has sucked since October 8th. I really wish I could say, "I lost my best friend. The whole ordeal sucks. And now I don't know how I feel or what I should do." I wish I could describe in detail what I saw and felt during the hours between leaving him at OKEU at 8 p.m. on Wednesday, 7th October, and him leaving me on Friday, 9th October. I do wish. Talking about him in the past tense will take some getting used to. But I'm lucky to have had him. I'm lucky to have known him. Overall, I am privileged to have been his life partner, his wife.
Thank you, Crystal. And now invite Andrita Lucien to move a tribute on behalf of the Lucien family.
Good afternoon to everyone. This tribute is on behalf of the in-laws of Kimani Riviere. My niece Crystal introduced Kimani to our family approximately 14 years ago. The two were inseparable, and this is where our journey with Kiki, our son, brother, grandson, nephew, cousin-in-law, and friend began. Ender, Kimani's mother-in-law, reflected, "I distinctly remembered when Crystal introduced me to Kimani. She gushed, 'Mommy, I love him and he really loves me.' Their 14 years together produced the most adorable and amazing grandson, the most precious and loving son-in-law, and a happy and fulfilled daughter. Over the years, Kimani has proven to be an authentic and loving person. My daughter knew what she was talking about. Kimani touched all our lives individually and collectively in a very special way. He loved Crystal and their beautiful son, Zan, unconditionally, and his love for them permeated our family. He loved us and we loved him. Kimani was a young, modern man with old-fashioned values. He knew how to love and care for his family, and despite the many hurdles in his way, he was able to nurture a deep and enduring relationship with each member of our family. To Kristin, Joel, Dwayne, and Devon, Kimani was the big brother, and they totally got on. He took an interest in their well-being and kept track of how they performed at school. He would call to congratulate them when they performed well, and he would get on their case if he felt they were messing up. He played his part to maintain a close relationship. He loved them and they loved him. Kristin had a particularly close connection with Kimani, and this is her reflection. Kimani, thank you for your sense of humor. Thank you for caring about my health while battling yours. Thank you for being understanding and coming to my rescue when I was upset with Crystal. Thank you for accepting me. Thank you for my amazing nephew. Thank you for being strong. Thank you for being you. I love you so much, and I want to give you thanks for being a big brother to me. I do miss you. You made my sister so happy, and I ask that you watch over her and comfort her in her time of grief. Until we meet again, big brother. Kimberly and Crystal are cousins who grew up together, and they are as close as sisters, which meant that Kimani and Kimberly got along like brother and sister, and they enjoyed good banter. In her own words, Kimani was a social introvert and a silent observer who loved fiercely. He was one of my favorite people, and I loved him dearly. We had a special bond, a seamless relationship, one of a patient older brother and a jovial younger sister. Being around him brought out the kid in me. I would often try to get a rise out of him with my antics, but he would feign exasperation, hide a smirk, and say, I'm not even taking you on. Or big woman like you? Or you just had to do that, eh? Or he would just pinch me. One would think that he was annoyed with me because of his remarks, but his actions spoke louder than words. Sometimes he was the one coming up with the pranks to play on Zan and Crystal, but I would be the one to carry them out. Kiki was someone you would always want to have on your team. I loved to tag team with him. He made me laugh and helped me put certain things into perspective. He shared with me his aspirations for Zan, his plans to keep Crystal happy, and a few business strategies he wanted to implement. I will forever be grateful for how he loved my cousin unconditionally, how he loved my nephew with every fiber of his being, how he loved me as a sister, my mother as an aunt, and my family as his family. Kiki, I am thankful for the time I got with you and miss you a lot, a lot, a lot. You were one of the greats. Rest in power, dear cousin-in-law. Simon and Gaspar lamented, Kimani was more than our nephew-in-law. Much, much more. He was our brother. He was our friend. He loved us and we loved him. He had our backs and we had his back. We honor him and we salute him. Gaspar remembers, Kimani was an astute businessman, a grounded guy, humble and hardworking. He was an honest and a straightforward individual who would not suppress his feelings about anyone or any given situation. He would respectfully say how he felt. As many would attest, COVID-19 affected everyone from all economic levels and backgrounds. As an entrepreneur, Kimani's business was impacted directly and severely. So, when life gave him lemons, he made lemonade. Kimani ventured into a new territory, and it was evident that he had put a lot of thought into it. One of his sales techniques was to give out samples of his specialty bread and as soon as he received feedback on his client's satisfaction, he would send them a price list. Simon reflects, I thank God for bringing Kimani into our lives. He gained my admiration and respect because of the way he stepped up to the mark and cared for my niece and nephew. A true gentleman, genuine person, and beautiful soul. I remember the long conversations we shared, whether it was about Crystal, business or investments, or just chit-chat. The times when he would pick me up at the airport to have some bonding time, when he would just pop around for a bit. The last time we spoke, he was trying to help me deliver a project. He was always ready to help. Kimani was not the type of person to sit and wait for somebody else to reach out to make the first move. As far as he was concerned, he was with Crystal, and Crystal's family was his family, and he just got on with it and sought ways to get to know the rest of the family. I am particularly grateful for the way Kimani kept an eye on Mama and Daddy. Whether it was an issue with the car, cable TV, or cell phone, he was always happy to look out for them. He was a good man. My own fondest memories of Kimani are how gentlemanly, transparent, and respectful he was. He had a strong yet quiet presence. His smile was captivating. He was a natural and a totally genuine person. We had deep conversations, and the way he got on with Kimberly and Crystal's siblings and the rest of our family, young and old, made him fit right in. Who he was and how he acted is a true testament to his remarkable mother, Mauricia. Kimani's love language was seen through acts of service and quality time. To know him was to love him. His legacy and the knowledge he imparted will continue to live on. He is gone in the flesh but remain with us in spirit. We will continue to honor his memory by loving his son, his mother, and of course his wife. Our Auntie Joan, Crystal's grandmother's sister, got to know and spend time with Kimani during her visits to St. Lucia, and in particular in 2018. He loved her and she loved him. When asked about what she would want included in our family's tribute, she was only able to find the strength to say, Kimani, you are gone, but you will never be forgotten. A constant reminder of you can be seen in the mark you left on the lives of your wonderful wife and precious son. I thank God for the short time we had together creating those treasured memories. Crystal's grandparents, who Kimani fondly remembered, referred to as Brother Luce and Maluce, enjoyed a very close bond with Kimani, and to them, Crystal had brought home a true gentleman and a son. Their bits and reflects their time together in this way. Kimani was a young man of character and integrity and carried himself with respect and dignity. When it came to helping people, Kimani was a natural. He had the gift of service. Another notable characteristic that Kimani possessed was the ease at which he got along with people. He was indeed a people's person. His life of service was demonstrated through his devotion with his mother, wife, and son, and took the best possible care of their needs, even in pain and sickness. He was a loving and caring husband and father to our granddaughter and great-grandson. He was a true and wonderful son-in-law. As elderly people, Kimani never made us feel like we were too old or a burden. He would come to us regularly and would hang around and speak with us for hours. He would never complain or make us feel uncomfortable. If we asked for help with anything, he was our technical advisor. We thank God for Kimani. He was a real blessing. Our entire family has been touched by this beautiful and wonderful soul, Kimani. We thank God Almighty for bringing him into this world to touch our lives in such a positive and profound way. He has taught us many lessons during our journey together, and we are thankful. We thank Mauricio for raising this fine gentleman, Kimani, and for sharing him with our family. We are sorry for your loss, and we grieve with you. Thank you, Crystal, for bringing Kiki into our family, and thank you, Zan, for sharing your daddy with us. We are sorry for your loss and we grieve with you. Our journey with Kiki, our son, brother, grandson, nephew, cousin-in-law, and friend, is filled with love, laughter, happiness, progress, straight talk, honesty, caring, and sharing. We will remember and treasure the times we shared, and we will remember Kiki forever. We mourn Kiki's premature and sudden passing, and we grieve individually and as a family. His last words to Crystal's grandmother when she said to him, "My son, you look tired, take it easy," were, "Don't worry, Malus, I will bounce back." In the face of adversity, he remained positive and showed empathy for others. He will always be in our hearts, our lives, and a part of our family. He was special. He loved us and we loved him. Kiki was family, our family.
Thank you, Andrita. And we now call upon Janelle Thomas to move a tribute on behalf of the Thomas family.
Good afternoon to all. This is a tribute presented on behalf of Kimani's family. The death of someone we love cracks us open. It's supposed to. There is no going back, ever. Someone we love has died, and life will never be the same. We will never be the same. Kiki, we honor the journey of our life of love we shared. You have departed from this earth school to your return to a new non-physical reality. The soul is, has no beginning nor end, but flows towards wholeness. You have achieved wholeness as you have impacted so many people in this physical realm. You left a huge earth family. A family of friends and loved ones who loved you and who have learned from your soul connection of your calm, peaceful, and humble nature. We learned and fed from your love cup. You loved us at the expense of your own pain and suffering. We wanted you to be with us forever, but you gave us more time than we deserved, as it came at an extremely painful cost. So today, we choose to honor your memory by allowing the heavens to be your new home in our minds. We want to honor you, Kiki, by being unselfish, allowing you to roam with our ancestors without the burden of pain and in the physical realm that it gave to us. It is not death that man should fear, but rather he should fear never beginning to live. But death and life, honor and dishonor, pain and pleasure, all these things equally happen to good men and bad. These things which make us either better or worse. You have lived with all and have maintained the good in a man and have been our teacher, as inevitably we too will follow the path to the realm that you now dwell in. You boarded, you set sail, you've made the passage. It's now time to disembark. If it's for another life, well, there's nowhere without God on that other side. If to nothingness, then you no longer have to put up with pain and pleasure or go on dancing on this battered crate, your body. So much inferior to that which serves it. One is mind and spirit. The other, earth and garbage. That clinging was not in the nature of life, and that the body is essentially mechanical and inferior to the mind. Death is a cessation of the impressions to the senses and the pulling of the strings that move the appetites and of the discursive movements of thoughts and of the service of the flesh. And most importantly, all the present movements is all that we have. When the longest and shortest lived of us dies, their loss is precisely equal, for the sole thing of which any of us can be deprived is the present, since this is all we own, and nobody can lose what is not theirs. Death smiles at us all, but all a man can do is smile back. It is now for us to learn from this side, for us to appreciate our time here. When you arise in the morning, think that precious privilege it is to be alive, to think, to enjoy, and to love. To all of us who are here, remember, live a good life. If there are gods and they are just, then they will not care how devout you've been, but will welcome you based on the virtues you have lived by. If there are gods but unjust, then you should not want to worship them. If there are no gods, then you will be gone, but will have lived a noble life that would live on and the memories of your loved ones. People only die when we stop speaking of their names. Kiki, I will not stop calling on you for counsel, even in your absence, from this physical realm, until we meet again in the afterlife. Farewell, our beloved.
Thank you, Janelle. And we now invite Odinga Charles, who is a friend, to move a tribute.
Today, I stand here with bitter but somewhat sweet emotions to deliver tribute to our beloved Kimani. Bitter because, as I fought through tears, I could not believe I was writing and referring to Kiki in the past tense, but sweet because it warmed my heart and made me happy hearing and reading so many wonderful things about my friend. You know, many times, it is when a person passes, we hear, he or she was nice, but, and something negative follows. But this time, not once did I ever hear any buts when it came to Kimani. Every comment was endearing. So I am here to share with you wonderful words and memories from some of Kiki's dearest friends, only because Crystal said to me, Odinga, I want you to do this because I know the boys are too senior, so it will be hard for them. So I choose you to deliver on yours and their behalves. So here goes. I read, laughed, and said to myself, this was our boy, as Darren said this. One of my favorite stories is one day we went to a bar, and he was not a drinker. However, Kimani had a very precise order. Club soda. 3 dashes of bitters, 6 half limes, and an extra highly iced with a few drops of simple syrup. Kimani then proceeded to squeeze the lime wedges into the glass and stirred it with a straw and sipped away with delight. Everyone looked in amazement and said, what on earth is that? Oh, it's LLB, lemon lime bitters, a very popular drink at the time, he responded. Everyone laughs, and he says, listen, it costs $7 at the bar. All of this is free. I laughed some more and cried too, reading the tribute from his dear friend Oren, who had the following to say. Hi, Auntie Mauricio, of course. Kimani was the best co-pilot I could ever ask for. Living so close by in Cap, he would always be the last to stop on the countless drop-offs we made after a party or getting food or whatever the reason we had to be out. The night would be over, he'd jump into the front seat and off we'd go. And like clockwork, I'd look about over 3 minutes later to see him fast asleep. We'd stop to let someone off, he'd wake up just enough to acknowledge someone got out and pass right back out again. A lot of times, the last stop was somewhere that would make driving to Cap feel like we were in Viewfort, which actually might have been a couple times, but along the way, every now and then, I'd hear, "You good?" Then I'd respond, "Yeah, man." And then he'd pass right back out again. Eventually, we'd get back to Cap. He'd wake up kinda, enough to say goodbye, and, "Ari, text me when you get home." And I don't know if it was because he was so well rested from the sleep in the car, but he always responded when I did. I was thinking about that the other day and realized that never stopped. Even though we lived so far away, time would go by and I'd get a random message from him about something, almost like a, "You good?" Sometimes the message actually said that. Whether he was asleep or far away, he was always there to make sure I was good. How could you ask for a better co-pilot? I'm going to miss you, my brother. Dylan called me and said, "I hope I didn't write too much, because there was so much I wanted to say, but just didn't know where to start." I said to him, "I know, hon. Try to keep it as simple as possible." He managed to do just that, as he wrote. "Today I'd like to pay tribute to a great man, a great friend, my brother from another mother. For nearly 30 years of my life, I had the honor of calling him my friend, a role he never took lightly. I remember looking forward to summer vacations in Soufre and our many adventures as children, our early teens in Entrepo playing Super Nintendo and Sega Genesis all day, only breaking to make macaroni and cheese and tuna fish and, of course, juice. One thing, give Kimani half a lime and a little sugar and he'd make a full jug of juice for you. He really loved this juice. Fast forward to adulthood and our many outings, parties, and social gatherings, experiences too numerous to mention. Kimani was a real lover and liver of life. Humble and never wanted to be a bother, but always a call away if you need him. I will miss our random link-ups and talks about any and everything. His advice, his chair, his genuine excitement whenever we cross paths. A proud husband and father. I am happy that our sons share a similar bond as we did, and I will always continue to be there for his family the best that I can. Fly with the angels, Kiki. God really needed the best of the best, and that's why he chose you. You will remain forever in my heart, my friend, my brother. Rest easy, gone too soon." As hard as it was reading these tributes, I had to do what I was appointed to do. I moved on to his dear friend, Cohen. Kiki, as we affectionately called him, was a dear friend of all seasons. He was there with you in good and the bad. He would always tell you what you needed to hear in his own blunt and refined manner. For sure, I'd miss our random meetings where I'd ride along with him on the daily runnings, reasoning on silliest to life-changing topics. Kiki, you were a true friend, a brother, responsible father, loving husband, and treasured son. Kimani, my brother, you will be solemnly missed. And now I move on to Aswad, another treasured friend of Kimani, as he said, to my friend, Kiki Lake. Didn't think for 1 minute that on Tuesday, 6th October, 2020, would be the last time I would see my friend, my brother, alive. A wonton soup and a V8 splash juice would be the last things I got for you. I miss you so much already, waiting for that random call saying, "Buddy, have you eaten?" If no, he would be like, "I'm coming to pick you up now." No need to answer, because he hung up already. If not a call, a WhatsApp message, "Everything good, bro? just always checking in. And whenever I don't hear from him in 2 days, I'd call him. He would be like, you know already, the body hurting. As soon as he was better, he would come to see me. You will always and forever be in my memories and will remind my daughter that her godfather was a superhero that always rescued Dad so many times, and will try to fill your shoes and be that father figure to Zan. Love you, my brother. Sleep in perfect peace. And then finally, the godfather of Kimani's son, Zan, had these words on his heart. Kimani is one of those rare and genuine friends who come into your life and quickly become his family. With his charismatic and caring personality, it was hard not to love him. His caring personality would make him leave his busy schedule to buy ginger tea and crackers, come over to your home, show up at your bedside, and say, "Oi, wake up. Make sure you drink this tea hot and eat everything for your upset stomach," and then walk out of the house like it was just a normal part of his day. One thing he's notoriously known for is the great hails he would receive, sometimes with both hands off the steering wheel, as we would drive past each other on the highway daily. Kiki gave me one of the greatest honors a friend could give. He made me the godfather of his son, who now outgrows shoes faster than any kid I know and has the appetite of a grown man. Let's not talk about the many lunch dates at Jade Terrace, where he would catch up on our businesses, the latest Ford or Chevy trucks, international news, or the new stress that our wife or fiance was giving us while encouraging each other to stay strong. Kimani was a brother who will never be forgotten. Fly high, my brother, until we meet again to enjoy some rice and corned beef. Through tears at this point, I had to say a few words coming from myself. By then, I understood where the guys came from when they told me there was so much to say, but did not know where to start. I will always remember Kimani for his random visits as we lived close enough at Cap Estate. Kimani was what you call a true friend. I have shared secrets with Kimani that he has never once shared with anyone. He made it very easy to just let out your fears, your insecurities, and anything, whether good or bad, to him. I mostly admire him for his strength and humility, his dedication to Zan as a father, commitment to Crystal as a husband, and respected him for the unconditional love he had for his mother. Kimani was a hard worker. With all these plans and with a busy life, he made time for me whenever I needed a friend. I am happy that I always got the opportunity to tell him how much I love and appreciate him. Thank you for being you, Kimani. Till the resurrection morning when we meet again, sleep in peace, my dear friend.
Thank you, Odenga. And we now call Pastor Dr. Timothy Robinson.
Pleasant good afternoon to you, family and friends. Firstly, on behalf of my wife and family and the pastors and ministers of the Streams of Power Ministries, we would like to extend our heartfelt condolences to the family and friends gathered here today. Kimani, a great man. I got a call from his wife, Crystal, a couple of weeks ago and said she would like me to do something at the funeral, and I said, well, what I can do is to pray for the family. I got a call about a week ago and she said, well, the prayers are very short. And we know how pastors like to speak already, right? Trust me, I will be very short. Though I'm asked to bring the tribute to, on behalf of, you know, even the ministry, myself. He was a great man. We read much about the faith heroes in Hebrews 11 in the scriptures. And for some, the list stops there. But throughout my lifetime, there has been a few who could be added to this list. Kimani is one of them, for it was by faith he lived, and it was by faith he endured to the end. And that was confirmed when I met with the family and a few friends. As a child, I understood he had such faith. A childlike faith. The thinking for some is that one has to be aged or live a long life to qualify to be a faith hero. But we could easily mark faith heroes by firstly their belief in God, their unwavering convictions, and their strength and endurance to the end. This is what Scripture says about faith heroes in Hebrews chapter 11. And all these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised, like Kimani. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. And people who say such things, says the scriptures, show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. But instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Many experienced great victories, while there were others who were tortured and afflicted. Some faced jeers and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning, they were sawed in two, and they were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. The Bible says they wandered in deserts and mountains and living in caves and in holes in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. Since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Jesus was only 33 years old when he said, "It is finished." And I often wondered why he could not have lived on a few more years to further impact the lives of others on earth, though being afflicted and despised for the good he did. But God's will was accomplished through him, and the fruit produced from the seeds he sowed still remains. The question is, are we to expect only successes and victories in this life? In this world, says Jesus, we will have tribulation, but in me you will have peace. Be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. Paul the apostle had a thorn in his flesh, which by some scholars was believed to be a physical infirmity, yet that did not stop him in his exploits. By faith he too endured to the end. Kimani had many victories, yet was faced with many obstacles. By faith he endured to the end. And there is a vast difference in knowing about someone or knowing a person. And it's out of relationship you truly get to know a person. And I'm happy that over the years I got to know Kimani. Kimani was a young man of faith, of strength and wisdom. An ambitious young man. One who carried himself well. He spoke softly yet profoundly. And his profound words resonated to his listeners. We have had many discussions on various issues and topics, and his wealth of knowledge and insight surpassed many. He was an intelligent young man. He was a loving, caring, considerate, respectful, and humble young man. He was a young man who loved his family dearly. And speaking in reference to his mom, Mauricia, his wife, Crystal, and his son, Zan, as those I have known personally. And to his mom, Mercia, his inner strength not only came from God, but from you. And we know that his seed and fruit will remain from one generation to the next. To his wife, Crystal, you have been a pillar of strength to him for many years, that which I know. Your love for each other withstood all challenges and obstacles. You are also, like him, very intelligent and very knowledgeable, strong in your point of view, though. Yet what I admired most about you is your submission to wise counsel, as I gave it, your willingness to adapt and to change to what God desires and not what you want. The unconditional love you express to your husband and son is commendable. And to his son, Zan, who is the fruit of the union, the likeness and image of Kimani and Crystal, there is no surprise as to who you are becoming, developing your own individuality with the very same virtues, values, and qualities Kimani and Crystal both possessed. When it comes to readiness, involvement, and participation, you put many at our Bible study classes to shame. Keep strong, Zan, and carry on the legacy. However, do not be pressured by the standards set before. Continue to develop that which is within you as God works within you to fulfill his purpose through you here on earth. And unto all those who are present and listening, Kimani was a good fruit tree with good fruit. The fruit's seed has impacted our lives in one way or another. And now that seed of this fruit has died in the soil of our hearts, may it bring forth much fruit in the seasons to come. I am indeed saddened by Kimani's early departure, yet happy I was able to be a part of his life and will continue to be a part of his family's life. May God strengthen all during this time of grief. Yes, he will be missed, but may his life and deeds not be forgotten. God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor Robinson. And before we have the eulogy, I would like to invite Lovina Reynolds to sing a special song as her tribute to Kimani.
Consider all of the works thy hands have made. I see the stars and I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. God, his son, not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away our sins. And take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I will bow in humble adoration.
On behalf of Kiki's family.
The eulogy, Ashanti Kimani Osai Riviere. Kimani was born to Mauricio Thomas and Leonard Joseph Riviere on 20th April 1983. He was given the mighty name Ashanti Kimani Osai, a tribute to his strong African heritage. Ashanti, a powerful ancient African empire, Kimani, an adventurer from the Kikuyu tribe, and Osai, the first ruler of the Ashanti Empire. His dad chose these dynamic names to reflect the strong man he wanted his son to be, although eventually distilled it down to the affectionate and loving pet name, Boyo. To almost everyone, he was simply Kiki. His family had no way of knowing at his birth the tremendous amount of strength he would require during his 37 years on this plane. At birth, Kiki was a bouncing, chubby, 10-pound baby. It was not until a few months into his life that his parents noticed the swelling of his eyes and limbs, coupled with long periods of heart-wrenching cries. He was eventually diagnosed with sickle cell anemia, which came as a shock to the family, since neither parent nor extended family was aware that a sickle cell trait ran in the bloodline. At the time of diagnosis, the prognosis and the life expectancy for persons diagnosed with sickle cell disease was poor. He suffered tremendous and excruciating pain and discomfort during sickle cell crises, and every time he got ill, Kiki's family cried and prayed for a miracle and a cure. Yet even at a young age, Kiki seemed to care more about the sadness and helplessness his family felt at his illness than about the pain he was feeling himself. At a tender age, Kiki displayed a level of discernment that was extraordinary for a child. As a testament to his observation, his mother recalled that Kiki was watching an interview of another child who suffered from sickle cell disease on TV, in which the child expressed that she often asked God, "Why me?" But Kiki was perplexed by the little girl's question and looked precociously at his mother and asked, "But mommy, why would she ask God this question? Why not her? If not her, it would be someone else." He was an intelligent child who developed very quickly, physically, cognitively, despite his challenges. He was mature beyond his years, made a great impression on all he met. Of course, his mother, a banker, and his dad, a popular lawyer, active politician, and parliamentary representative from Sufra, Kiki grew up surrounded and influenced by not just his immediate family, but an entire community consisting of all persons of all walks of life, all of whom embraced and loved him dearly. Such exposure naturally impacted his warm and humble personality. He was encouraged to read and receive various collections of books, which piqued his interest in reading from a very early age. He was always a pleasure watching this little Kiki and his dad sitting side by side reading and passionately sharing information, and sometimes engaged in lively debates that erupted once they completed the book. Reaganomics and the like. Excuse me. His mother recalled that from age 4, Kiki was conversant about the Cold War, Reaganomics, and the like. No conversation was too intellectual for Kiki, and he would gladly reference his sources, namely Newsweek, The Times, The Economist, and the BBC. His parents nurtured his curiosity, and his dad exposed his Aristotle 12 virtues: courage, temperance, magnificence, magnanimity, ambition, patience, friendliness, truthfulness, wit, modesty, justice, liberality. Kiki absorbed the teaching like a sponge. His mom recalls fondly that before he was able to pronounce these words, he recited these virtues to a very speechless and elated Brother George Odlum during one of his visits to the home at Sufra. Bridget George's reaction was, "Dada, you can bet your money on this little guy. He will grow up to be a critical thinker, a realist, one who questions everything to arrive at the facts." These virtues were manifested throughout Kiki's life. At school, his teachers marveled and how sharp and resourceful he was despite his prolonged periods of absence from classes due to bouts of illness. His primary school teacher recalled how he often outperformed students with normal status and unbroken attendances. He passed common entrance exam with ease and became one of two students to succeed for St. Mary's College from his entire district of Sufre that year. Kiki was fortunate to have experienced a diverse school community, having attended several primary and secondary schools in different districts on the island and at different stages of his school life. Out of an abundance of caution, his dear mother always ensured that he was close to her. Wherever her professional life took her, she moved with her beloved Kiki. He embraced all these opportunities to meet new people and quickly forge new relationships all along the journey. He was always respectful, mature, and very attentive. He never hesitated to share with everyone he met his utter respect for an unconditional bond of love between him and his dear mom. And he was much loved and missed his deceased dad, whom he lost when he was just 18 years of age. Kiki embraced life so fully that he was easy to forget about his illness, except when a crisis struck. His family marveled at the way he navigated adult life. He completed a degree in culinary art from the Florida Culinary Institute, pursued many other areas of interest. He enjoyed a short stint in property management following a successful completion of real estate management course at Monroe College, taught at the then Grizzly Secondary School, and eventually started his own business, Good Sutley Sea, a cafe at the GFL Charles Airport. Kimani found love, his mom recalls, some 14 years ago on his return from Barbados, where he was spending time with his cousin John. He embraced her, and with a beam of excitement, he shared, "Mommy, I met the one. She's beautiful. She's a Christian. I know you will love her." He was referring to Crystal, who would become his wife and mother to his adorable son, Zan. Kiki loved his family wholeheartedly and was the most attentive, loving, and caring husband that any woman would yearn for. Above all, Kiki was truly a family man who prioritized the needs of his household, a model father who, from day one, embraced fatherhood with all his heart and was there for his son Zan at every milestone, including Zan's 13th birthday, which was just 2 weeks before that fateful Friday. He showered his son with love, support, attention, and instilled in him good fashion values and morals he had learned as a child when capitalized on every opportunity to bond with Zan. Kiki passed on many remarkable qualities from his extraordinary father, particularly the love of cooking. Together, he and Zan whipped up many recipes, and Kiki was sure to teach his son many of the culinary secrets his father taught him in addition to his own creations. Kiki certainly did not let his medical condition slow him down. If anything, it spurred him to become more gregarious and involved in his community. He lived and thrived, He was driven, ambitious, flexible, and motivated to succeed against all odds. He did not allow sickle cell anemia to be a roadblock, but only a nuisance on his winding path of life. He worked hard at what he loved and was determined to become a successful entrepreneur. He treated his staff, his suppliers, and the wider GFL, Charles' family, with respect and dignity. He forged many new relationships from the region and beyond, the persons who, because of his active travel schedules, traversed the GFL Charles Airport, where he operated his cafe from the departure lounge. He maintained a friendly, approachable, and sociable personality throughout. Kiki had many cherished, loyal, and fiercely protective friends with whom he shared a strong bond and mutual love. Most of his friendships were maintained from childhood. No doubt they will miss him dearly. He maintained his avid love for reading and kept abreast of local, regional, and international news. He did not hesitate to share his perspective on issues passionate to him. His main concern was the level of social and economic inequality which exists in the world and the lack of compassion. While his health did not allow him to actively participate in sports, he loved playing video games and was an avid cricket fan. He enjoyed watching a cricket game and discussing the subject passionately with his stepfather, Marshall, whom he respected and cared for deeply. Over the years, sickle cell crisis racked his body, becoming more severe and frequent as time progressed. However, Kiki never felt that slow his desire to provide for his family and maintain a continued interest in everyone around him. His last venture was a baking business that he was excited about marketing and getting off the ground. Throughout his life, Kiki and his family longed for a cure for sickle cell. He kept himself fully abreast with every aspect of the sickle cell disease through ongoing reading and research. He would get extremely excited every time he read about clinical trials on research for a cure and would share his excitement with the family. His dear mom would always assure him that she would invest everything she had to restore his health once the cure was found, and the grateful Kiki would simply say, "Yes, Mom, I know, I believe, and thank you, Mom." In his quest to sensitize and educate on the nature of the disease, he went as far as addressing the Medical and Dental Association at one of their AGMs. He almost vividly shared the tremendous pain that sicklers experience during crisis and sensitivity, ongoing attention and empathy needed by the health system in administering care to these patients at the health institutions. It was his desire that while a cure was not yet forthcoming, that sickle cell patients would be able to find some much needed soulagement in our health and care system. He was a man of compassion, sincerity, and kindness. He was always quick to ask how you were doing and took interest in his friends, his family, and acquaintances. His illness made it easy for him to understand the suffering and limitations of others. He used his experience to support and bring comfort to persons who were in pain. The overwhelming outpour of condolence and support from many persons from across St. Lucia and beyond speaks volumes of the tremendous impact he created during his lifetime. The general refrain has been that he was humble, caring, intelligent, ambitious, witty, and a consummate gentleman. On Friday, October 9th, 2020, at the age of 37, Kimani drew his last breath after fighting his last sickle cell crisis, which was triggered by a bout of dengue fever. The Merriam-Webster dictionary defines perseverance as continued effort to do or achieve something despite difficulties, failure, or opposition. Our beloved Kiki beat the odds. That little boy who was not promised to his family for very long persevered through countless excruciating crises to build, strive, succeed, love, and leave an indelible mark on his family and friends. He had sobbed, we have sobbed for him until our stomachs and heads hurt. But then we are comforted by the thought that despite his pain and uncertainty about the future, Kiki lived a fulfilled and happy life, one filled with compassion for the less fortunate, unconditional love for his family, his love for God, the positive relationships he maintained. Above all, he is now pain-free. He is survived by his wife, his son, his mother, his stepfather, his siblings, Kwame, Amma, his many cherished aunts and cousins. Kimani, you were the definition of perseverance. We will miss you and love you always. We will remember and miss your jokes, the laughter we shared. So with the angels, Boya, and please listen to our conversations as we will continue to share the beautiful stories of your life. Enjoy your rightful place in God's kingdom, our dearest Kiki, until we meet again.
Thank you, Simon. And at this juncture, please allow me to recognize a few persons. The Honorable President of the Senate, Honorable Speaker of the House, members of Parliament, we say welcome. And welcome again to everyone to this service of our beloved Kimani Revere. Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Praise be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our afflictions, and thus enables us to comfort those who are in trouble, with the same consolation we have received from him. Blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
I bless the body of Ashanti Kimani Osei with the holy water that recalls his baptism, of which St. Paul writes, "All of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. By baptism into his death, we were buried together with him, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him by likeness to his death, so shall we be united with him by likeness to his resurrection." On the day of his baptism, Ashanti Kimani Osei put on Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, may he be clothed with glory.
We now sing the entrance hymn, "You are my all in all."
Turn off your microphones, choir members, please. My brothers and sisters, we have come together to renew our trust in Christ, who by dying on the cross has freed us from eternal death and by rising has opened for us the gates of heaven. Let us pray for our brother Kimani, that he may share in Christ's victory, and let us pray for ourselves, that the Lord may grant us the gift of his loving consolation. Let us pray. O God, who have set a limit to this present life so as to open up an entry into eternity, we humbly beseech you by the grace of your mercy. You command the name of your servant, Ashanti Kimani Osei, to be inscribed in the book of life through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
You sit, please. We invite those doing the readings to come up, Kai Revere and Claire Seromain. The first reading is taken from the Book of Lamentations, chapter 3, verses 22 to 26.
My soul is shut out from peace. I have forgotten happiness. And now I say, my strength is gone. The hope which came from the Lord, brooding on my anguish and affliction, is gall and wormwood. My spirit ponders in continually and sinks within me. This is what I shall tell my heart, and so recover hope. The favors of the Lord are not all past. His kindness are not exhausted. Every morning they are renewed. Great is his faithfulness. My portion is the Lord, says my soul, and so I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who trust in him, to the soul that searches for him. It is good to wait in silence for the Lord to save. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
second reading is taken from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 11, verses 13 to 16.
All these died in faith before receiving any of the things that had been promised. But they saw them in the far distance and welcomed them, recognizing that they were only strangers and nomads on earth. People who use such terms about themselves make it quite plain that they are in search of their real homeland. They can hardly have meant the country they came from, since they had the opportunity to go back to it. But in fact, they were longing for a better homeland, their heavenly homeland. This is why God is not ashamed to be called their God, since he has founded the city for them. The word of the Lord.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Chapter 12, verses 23 to 26. Jesus said to his disciples, "Now the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you, most solemnly, unless a wheat grain falls on the ground and dies, it remains only a single grain. But if it dies, it yields a rich harvest. Anyone who loves his life loses it. And anyone who hates his life in this world will keep it for the eternal life. If a man serves me, he must follow me. Wherever I am, my servant will be there too. If anyone serves me, my Father will honor him." The Gospel of the Lord.
I wish to welcome everyone who is here this afternoon. Certainly it's not the numbers we would have had under normal circumstances. Mauricio, Crystal, there would have been a full house. But thank God we are not in the early days of COVID when only 10 people were allowed. It was a very painful moment for me to know that there are other family members who could have been there and they couldn't be. But then you still suffered a little bit, because we are down to 100 because of the increase in numbers, an increase in the number of cases. We are at 131, and that is quite a bit. So I welcome, on behalf of the family, the Speaker of the House, the President of the Senate, the senators, the parliamentarians who are here. Welcome Pastor Tim and the members of the Streams of Power Tabernacle, and well-wishers, friends, and those who are following us live stream. Please pray for us, because this is the moment of farewell, and it can be very, very tough. So our condolences go to Marissa and her family, to the Riviere family, to Crystal, his wife, and Zan, his son. Thank you so much, all of you, for those wonderful tributes. We were listening intently in the back in the sacristy. Very, very moving, very touching, true to the person that we all knew. And Jonelle, if you had not, I'm not sure who Jonelle is, but if you had not considered a path of poetry and writing, I think you have it. Yeah, those words were so poetic, and I kept on smiling and telling Dignan Popo, my, this is such so poetic. So give it some thought. My dear friends, according to the laws of nature, Kimani was supposed to bury his mother. That's how it should go. According to the laws of nature, Crystal and Kimani were supposed to live to a ripe old age. According to the laws of nature, Zan should have been burying his father. But everything has changed. Something that we have no control over. And this makes death so painful, so very painful. In the 32 years of priesthood, I've experienced and presided over all types of death. From the stillborn child to that of my 110-year-old cousin. See the span? And that wide span included babies, children, young people, middle-aged persons, the elderly, the sick, with all types of illnesses and debilitating problems, all types. These included persons who died suddenly, persons who died accidentally, and those who died violently. I have presided over quite a few military funerals for the police, formal funerals for parliamentarians, state funerals for prime ministers and governors general, a very wide spectrum. Every one of them was painful for their families and loved ones. Every single one of them. What I heard of Kimani is what I have written, because I came to know Kimani when he was 11 years old. Because I had moved from my first assignment in Larissus, Denry, to the parish of Souffre. And as I said, Souffre, let me welcome Father Albert Smith, who made the trek from Souffre to be here in spite of the weather. And Deacon Popo, of course, is a friend of the family. The Kimani that I knew when I met him when he was 11 years old and grew to this 37-year-old, was a very good and decent young man. So what I heard about him today in the tributes were the things that I knew all along. In any case, Mauricio wouldn't have had it otherwise, eh? Nor his father. His choice of friends, his mother, his stepfather, his son, his wife, they knew all of his friends, every one of them. And this is something that is exemplary, that your family, your loved ones know whom you are liming with, who you are associating with, because sometimes that would need some level of guidance. But because of the character of the young man, he chose friends who were like-minded, among them my own nephew, Kumani Isaac. What do we take with us today, having heard all that has been said about Kimani? What comes to my mind, and as I was reflecting on what it is that I was going to share with the congregation today, and it has kind of fallen right in line with all the tributes, is it's about relationships. Our life here on earth is about relationships, that we take no one for granted. But the persons whom we are in relationships with, we have to make sure we cherish those relationships and we cherish every moment. It means that the relationships that wives and husbands share, that matters. And there should be no time wasted. So here it is, the exemplary husband that Kimani was, and was able to devote so much time to his wife and to his son. Such clarity that Zan would, with such clarity that he would talk about his father as a 13-year-old, and to use to be so eloquent. But you see, he had to be eloquent because it was not made up. Zan was speaking from his heart of what he knows about his father from the time he became conscious, and so was Crystal. So relationships between husband and wife, we have to relate, because we do not know when that relationship will be severed. The relationship between parents and children, not taking our parents for granted and not taking our children for granted, because we do not know how long we are going to have them. The relationship among siblings. You know, sometimes, you know, we just take it for granted. Well, he's my brother, she's my sister. The relationship between friends, between colleagues, and between neighbors. My friends, in talking about relationships, we need to let those persons in our lives know how we feel about them. You know, so often we communicate what it is that we don't like, how they have upset us or hurt us. But so often we do not communicate gratitude. We do not communicate respect. We do not communicate with them, to them, that we love them. And you see, this is so difficult. This is so difficult. But I'm so glad. I'm so glad that Zan had the opportunity to hear his daddy telling him time and again, I love you. Because you see, especially for our men folk who either have a near absence or a total absence of fathers in their lives, they often do not know, or they have often never heard the word, the expression, I love you. And one cannot give what they don't have. So if we have not been told I love you, and we experience the love, it's difficult to tell another that I love you. But we need to try. Those persons who are in our lives, we need to say it to them. And not to postpone it, to say it to them now. And if you have been saying it, say it again. So when you go home, when you meet loved ones at home, those who are not here with us this afternoon in the church, and those of you who are listening and following us live stream, tell your loved ones that you love them. Tell your wife, tell your husband that you love her, you love him. Parents, tell your children that you love them. Children, tell your parents that you love them. Siblings, tell your brothers, your sisters that you love them. Neighbors, tell your neighbors you love them. Colleagues, tell your colleagues you love them. You know why? Because we may not get that opportunity again. I have experienced so many times that the tears that many, not all, but the tears that many shed at funerals are not so much, they're not expressed so much because of the loss, but because of the regrets. The remorse that I did not do, I did not say, I did not express. Let not that moment pass us by. Please, when you go home this evening, say it. Say it maybe for the first time. It may feel awkward. It may sound awkward, but say it all the same. If you have said it before, say it again. Repeat it. And get in the practice of doing it so that when the time comes, you would have no regrets. One of the things that have helped me in my own losses, I have had many, lots of family members. I just lost my last uncle in June of this year, my father's brother, only brother. I've had from accidents to homicide, just name it, painful experience. But you know something? One of the common denominator when I speak with my siblings, the common denominator is that we have no regrets. Because I know that I have tried to be there for my family as often as I could. When I came from my studies in 2002, I got home in June, and I said, you know something? You've got to be with your family on your day off every Tuesday. And as many Tuesdays as I could, I went home. I was home in June. My father was dead on the 17th of October. Had I not been going in those few months, I would have regretted. When I went to the cathedral the month after, that was 2002 in November, I continued to go because my mother was there and my aunts and my sister and so on. And one day, the secretary told me that somebody came to see me. And when the person was told that, you know, Father Michel is on his day off, the person asked, what is the priest doing with his day off, with a day off? Well, they didn't know. I knew. Because my mother would die 3 years after my father, and we were very close. And I have not regretted any of the losses I have suffered in my life. I have missed them dearly, but I have not regretted to say, had I known, I would have been there often. I would have visited more often. No regrets whatsoever. The worst of my losses, my family's losses, was in 2007, when my nephew had an accident with two of the neighbor's children who were first cousins, and they all died. One on the same day, 5 days later, my cousin 2 weeks later, and my nephew, 2 weeks later, And my sister, my nephew's mother, the very day of his funeral, she succumbed. So in 1 month, we had 4 deaths. Listen, this thing knocked me over. It knocked me over. But you know something? I never questioned God. I never did. And my nephew, I raised him. Because when his father died, being his uncle and godfather, I thought it was my time to look after him. So he spent time with me in Larissus and then in Soufré. Grew up to be a fine young man. Up to now, my nieces and nephews, they are telling me, yes, you spoiled him. I didn't. I tried not to, but they are telling me I did. So, but you know something? That day, I remember when my nephew was being buried. And we got news of my sister's death at the hospital. We happened to sing that song, God Gives His People Strength, as a responsorial after the first reading. I couldn't trust myself to do my nephew's funeral. So I asked Monsignor Anthony to preside. And I was sitting next to him. And when they started singing this song, I leaned over to him and I said, it is true. God gives his people strength. I knew that song when it came out in the early 70s. And I loved it so much that I learned every verse by heart and in the order that it is written. But you know, all along, I knew the song. That day, I came to know the person who gives us strength. And I hope that, you know, Marissa and Crystal and all of you will feel the strength of God to carry you through this difficult, difficult patch. So it's all about relationships, my friends, because we may not get the opportunity to show love, gratitude, and even forgiveness. It's also about those whom we touch by our lives. Just yesterday, the world heard of the death of Alex Trebek, the host of Jeopardy for so many years. And in an interview before he died, knowing that he was suffering with pancreatic cancer, he said that he hoped that his life has touched other lives in a positive way. And that's what it's about. It's about our lives touching another life. Sometimes we're not even aware that we have touched people that way, but we should always strive to do it. Has Kimani's life touched my life? Of course. Because, as I said before, I encountered a decent man, a very respectful young man, a kind young man with pleasant demeanor, and you added the other attributes in your tribute. He could have chosen the wrong path, but he didn't. He could have chosen the wrong set of friends, but he didn't. One of the things we question God about, and somebody mentioned it with Kimani, so seeing that little girl who was suffering from leukemia and asking God, why me? You see, the world has taught us to be afraid of suffering, so that there is an antidote for everything that aches and that pains, because we must not suffer at all. But you know something? Suffering is redemptive. Redemptive for ourselves, but also redemptive for others. And sometimes the Lord does not ask us to cooperate with him and to say, well, I'm going to send you a little suffering in your life. It's not really meant for you, but it's to help somebody. It's to help save a soul out there. He doesn't tell us anything like that. We just experience it. And so Kimani shared in the suffering of Christ. And we know our Lord was sinless. The best person you could have found in the world. Yet see how much he suffered. So Kimani, he shared in the suffering of Christ in his own illness for the greater part of his life. This suffering has purified him to make his suffering acceptable, to make him an acceptable offering to Christ. Christ called him back to himself when all the impurities were burnt away in the fires of pain and suffering. It's like he was in the furnace. But you see, when gold and silver and other precious metals are put in the furnace burns away everything that is not the real thing. So what you are left with, though small, is the real thing. So over the years, Kimani has been being tried and tested in that fire of suffering. And now, when the Lord had refined him fully, he took him back to himself. Death does not end in the grave. One of the most painful experiences is to see one's loved one being lowered in the grave, being lowered in the tomb. And that is when I always ask people to be sensitive, because this is the last time family members will be seeing their loved ones. And silence is golden at that time. So death does not end in the grave. Jesus' death gives us this assurance that death does not end in the tomb. Death, where is your victory? Death, where is your sting? The scripture tells us. So while we are stricken with grief, know that one day we will see our loved ones again. So one day we will see Kimani again. And he will welcome us with this bright, broad, lovely smile that was characteristic of him. That was his signature, yeah? The signature smile. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me, even though he or she dies, will live forever. And we have to believe that because we are Christians. If Jesus was not true when he said this, we would have been fooled. But he was speaking the truth. He didn't fool us. He didn't dupe us. That one day we will see our loved ones again, because Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. We place Kimani in the arms of our loving Father and ask him to grant him his eternal reward in heaven. He has done good things while he lived this life, giving good advice, good counsel, sharing and caring for and with other people. We pray that the Lord may heal your grieving hearts, because in the coming days, weeks, and months ahead, you will still be hurting. But we pray with you and for you that you would remember Kimani with the greatest of affection and fondness as you do now, but with far less pain than you're experiencing now. Amen. Please stand as we bring our prayers before the Lord, trusting that what we ask in faith, He will grant to us.
Could those who are doing the prayers of the faithful come forward, please?
And kindly go to the microphone of the animator, where Mrs. Popo is. Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father where he intercedes for his church, confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus. We join our prayers to his.
Dear God, we pray for the head of our church, Pope Francis, the Archbishop Robert Rivas, the clergy, and religious leaders of all denominations. God, may your Holy Spirit continue to guide our church. We pray that our sacred institution may be a beacon of hope and truth in these trying times. As we navigate these uncertain months due to this worldwide pandemic, may your church continue to serve as a spiritual foundation and inspiration for all people. And draw your children even closer to you as we look forward to your glorious return. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Prayer for the family. Heavenly Father, we pray for the peace that surpasses all understanding as Kimani's family grieves for him. Lord, send your Holy Spirit to grant them strength and courage as they try to continue this earthly journey without him. Comfort them, dear God, and shower them with your divine love. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Prayer for the sick. Dear God, we pray that you touch the lives of all who are sick and suffering. We pray for healing and comfort. Ease their pain and affliction and grant them strength and peace. Renew them in body, mind, and spirit. We ask for your protection and grace for all medical professionals who are courageously treating the sick, bedridden, and diseased. May they be shielded, strengthened, and guided as they administer healing treatment and care. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Prayer for our nation. Almighty God, in these times of challenge, unite our island and guide our leaders with wisdom and discernment as they manage the affairs of our country. Strengthen their faith and give them clarity of thought to make the hard decisions. Grant us patience and love for our fellow men as we build a future in which all may prosper and share through our Lord Jesus Christ. All above all, we want you to be in the helm of our nation. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the world, dear God, bless our world leaders with wisdom, courage, and insight in the time of change and uncertainty. Lord, make this world a place where no one goes hungry and where everyone is treated equally, irrespective of race or creed. A world of freedom and justice for all, where love and humanity overcome hate. Dear God, you are the great physician. Look favorably on your children and the world you created, and heal us from this pandemic which now threatens our very existence. We pray that the world leaders are courageous and make the decisions necessary to save lives. Lord, have mercy on the world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Let us pray finally for ourselves and our loved ones, that the Lord may protect each one of us here against a sudden and unprovided death. We pray to the Lord. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in the kingdom through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be seated, please.
The collection will be taken in aid of the St. Lucia Sickle Cell Association, so please give generously. We now call upon those who are going to take the collection. And we sing the hymn, Shout to the Lord.
Yeah.
This funeral service includes Holy Communion, and so we prepare ourselves by acknowledging our union with the Father. And so, at our Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to pray. Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever." Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Have mercy, have mercy. the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. There will be three stations for Holy Communion so that we can speed up a little bit. The weather is not too nice. So I'll come to the center half of the church, and those of you there will come up. There are four tables with hand sanitizer. So those of you in the second half of the church, you need to go on the side wings and come up. Because the hand sanitizers are at the back table. The same thing for those who are in the front. You need to go down the side wings. The hand sanitizers are on the table in the middle part of the church, and then you come up. And Deacon David Popo will be on one side, Father Albert will be on the other. When you have received communion, those of you in the first half of the church next to the casket, please make your exit on the side and not go back on the aisle again. You may proceed. Those of you who have your own hand sanitizer can come for communion.
For communion, we sing, "We Remember."
We remember how you loved us.
Let us pray.
Please stand.
Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that your servant, Ashanti Kimani Osei, who has journeyed from this world, may by this sacrifice be cleansed and freed from sin, and so receive the everlasting joys of the resurrection through Christ our Lord.
Would those signing the register please come forward? And at this time, we also have a special rendition. He understands my tears.
He understands my tears. It's hard to believe he still loves you. No. Words get in the way. I
stand for the final commendation.
The church says amen.
Trusting in God, we have prayed together for Ashanti, Kimani, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see Kimani again and enjoy his friendship. Although this congregation will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ.
We now have another special rendition, Oceans.
Waters, your sovereign hand would be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never fail and you won't stop now. So I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the wave. When oceans rise, so will rest in your embrace. For I am yours and you are. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you will call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. And my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. And take me deep.
deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. So I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine. Oh.
Our response to the song of farewell: receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
Receive his soul and present him to God.
Saints of God, come to his aid. Hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord.
Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham.
Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him.
Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Kimani, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Kimani in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Ashanti Kimani Osei, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham. And where Lazarus is poor no longer, may you find eternal rest. In peace, let us take our brother to his place of rest. Dear friends, as you know, with the new protocols, only 25 persons are allowed in the cemetery. The weather is not even looking too good, so we may have to say goodbye to you here. And those of you who may, if you have your umbrellas, to follow us to the cemetery, but bear in mind it is only 25 who are allowed. That would be the immediate members of the family. And we have the Minister of Health with us, and I will not want to be counted on a bad list. Yeah? So I want to make sure that they know St. Joseph the Worker Parish, Grosile, is one of those parishes that really adhere to the protocols. And I have my parliamentary rep to attest to that.
Before we sing our final recessional song, the family of Kimani would like to thank every one of you, each person here, for your presence. It means a lot to them. We want to thank all those who sent cards, flowers, and kind expressions of sympathy to them, and also your generosity and support at this difficult time was very much appreciated and of great comfort to the entire family. So our recessional song is, all I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you.
Loving you. All I
invite some people to take their wreaths, please.
Stay for all time.
touch the last time, I will love you, love you. Till the storms fill my eyes, and we touch the last time.